Today we're going to kind of move to another layer or another level in the progression we've been on since the first Sunday of the year. The first Sunday of the year, we talked about the beauty and the benefit of having a clean slate before God, before one another. And then last week, we talked about this notion that our faith is not a series of snapshot events, but it's a daily journey that we take. And that what makes the clean slate matter is that that journey is a journey of transformation. And so as we allow Christ to transform us, those things that we once wiped off of our slate hopefully don't appear again, or at least don't appear as much. And so we're on this continuing journey. John Wesley said, we're moving on toward perfection by God's grace. Today we're going to talk about what for centuries now has been very much the primary vehicle through which Christians have felt that transforming power and have had the opportunity to live into their faith and find their call and be part of the ministry of the gospel, which is the church. And we're going to talk a little bit about the nature of the church. But as I was watching and listening this morning just in this service, I don't think we really need much more than like the last 20 or 25 minutes, at least I don't, for evidence that the gathering of believers is significant in the life of faith. How many of you can sing Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah like that sitting in your living room? It's impossible. That kind of thing only happens when we come together. There's something about the hymns and the way they come through and the way Mary plays them on the organ that brings out a sense of majesty that you can't capture in the pop sound that comes on the radio. And it reminds us of the majesty of God. There's something about the comfort that comes from listening to the special music. I was listening in the gospel airs. You guys did such an awesome job with the prelude. And I was sitting here. This is going to sound horrible probably, but I'm saying it anyway. I was sitting up here thinking, I just wish I had a pillow that I could put my head on and just kind of drift off with that being the last thing that I heard, because I have no doubt that it would be very restful, peaceful sleep, and with wonderful dreams of hopefully what God has in store for us. We don't get that. You don't get that on the television. You don't get that on the radio. Even if we watch the gospel airs on TV, you can, by the way, if you ever miss it, on YouTube, you guys are usually showing up there whenever you guys sing. But it's not the same as being in the room and experiencing with all of your senses. There's something about coming together with one another and being able to share our prayer requests, knowing that it's not just me or you that's dealing with whatever it is, but we've now shared it with a community that will pray for us and pray with us and love us. All of that is essential to that ongoing transformation, because it's uplifting and it's accountable and it's compassionate. It's wonderful. And it's very counter the nature of the world. Because if we're going to talk about the nature of the church, we got to kind of butt it up against the nature of the world, because there's supposed to be contrast. And there is. If we think about the nature of the world, the nature of the world tends to be about ambition. The nature of the world tends to see personal gain as a primary goal. The nature of the world tends to want to or somehow thrive on embracing a sense that there are some people who are better than others and other people who are less than others. The nature of the world tends to be more individually, more than communally driven. It's about me getting mine. It's about me amassing as much as I can. And the sense of privilege is less about I am privileged to give, and the nature of the world is more the world should be thankful for the privilege of having me give into it. The has a sense of what the world has done to our priorities, to our attitudes. There's many times, even in charitable endeavors, I've met CEOs of some very benevolent organizations that have great missions. But if you met the CEO, you would never know it. Because there's an arrogance and an attitude and other things that aren't reflective of the mission of that organization. And so simply being part of an organization does not necessarily mean that one buys into the traits that should drive that organization. Even us, I mean, I don't think I'm alone in this, but when we do something nice, we do something kind, we do something charitable, there's usually that little part of us that's saying, boy, I hope somebody notices. There's that part that says, you know, I'd like to be lifted up. I'd like to be recognized for this. And that is suppressed or embraced, depending on the person, in a million different forms. And when we look at the nature of the church, it flips all that stuff upside down. When we look at, and we're going to use Acts 2 and Acts 6 to kind of zone in on this, but you look at Acts 2, and it's such a great representation of what the church should look like. It talks about that the people that came to faith, what they did is they gathered regularly. They ate meals together. Every day they were spending time together. They were drinking in the teachings of the apostles so they could learn more about Jesus and grow their faith and build their faith together in community. It wasn't individual. It was community. And if you look from the very beginning to the very end of Scripture, faith has always been something that is best lived out and thrives by necessity in community. Every letter of Paul was written with an assumption underneath it that that letter was not written to an individual. That letter was written to a community. Even the letters of the written to Timothy, who you could say, you know, well, what about Timothy? That's only one name. That was just written to him. Certainly. But all through that letter, what Paul is doing is trying to help Timothy understand what it means to be part of the community in which he was ministering. It's a communal thing. And it tells us that they were generous with one another. Instead of seeing other people and saying, you should be grateful for what I've done for you, they say, I am grateful that I am able to do for you. And it talks about their generous giving out of their abundance to make sure that other people that were in need in their community were being lifted up. It's a complete opposite of the nature of the world. Now, we're going to get back to that stuff in a second, but there's another piece that is kind of between the lines and a lot of the stuff in the book of Acts, and it's, you know, it talks about them getting together, and when we think about the church getting together, where do you picture? Do you picture your living room? You picture here. You picture a sanctuary. You picture a fellowship hall. But that's not what was happening back then. They didn't have churches like this. They met in people's homes. They met in public communal venues. The apostles, when they were preaching, they were preaching in a synagogue. They were preaching in some place that was public, that was known for people to come and talk loudly there. But there wasn't anything like what we associate with the church. In other words, the church literally was the people. And so this first thing that I want you to realize about the nature of church is it's not about an institution. The nature of church is not institutional. The nature of the church is not a facility. The nature of the church is a community of people who come together with a common belief in Jesus Christ. That's the church. And then we see the second piece of the nature of the church and the thing that I was mentioning a moment ago, but I want to highlight this piece in Acts 6. In Acts 6, it's the beginning of a story that unfolds of a guy named Stephen. And some of you may have heard about Stephen and why they accepted him as the first Christian martyr. But what we see here at the beginning of chapter 6 tells us something else about the nature of the church, about the nature of the people that were part of the church. It said that there was a need that arose in the community, that there was a group of widows who weren't being properly cared for. So the apostles said, we got to solve this problem. But they were honest about it. They came, they brought everybody together, and they said, look, we're preaching and teaching, and that's taking every ounce of time and strength that we have. We know this needs to be done. We can't do it. So we need you guys to get a few folks together to lead the charge and meet this need. And lo and behold, 7 people showed up. And they took hold of that ministry, and they just solved the problem. They made it happen. And so the nature of the community is to serve. The nature of the community is not, what have you done for me lately? The nature of the community is, I am coming to offer my gifts in service to God and in service to one another. It's coming with an expectation rather than waiting for someone to just fill our cup. The nature of the community is to give and pour ourselves into whatever God calls us to pour ourselves into. If you know, there's something that's interesting about this passage in Acts 6. The people that brought up the issue were not the widows saying, what's the matter with you? You're not giving me my food. It was other people in the congregation. It was other people in the community that noticed the need and said, hey, these ladies are quietly suffering over here. That's not right. We need to do something about it. And so what happens is when we all embrace that nature of a servant, we are giving into the community, meeting others' needs. We're not necessarily doing it for anything in return, but if we all do our part, other people are going to meet our needs. And so it's this natural, mutually beneficial connection that happens when the communal nature of the church comes together with a servant nature of the church. And we look and feel and are different than the world. Why do you think the church was growing so rapidly? Why was it thriving? It's thriving because the people looking in saw something so radically different from what they saw in the world. What they saw in the world was take, 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 scrape to survive. And then you look at this group of people that are unrelated and yet they're family. And you see this group of people that their only agenda is to love and to care and to serve. And you see that they're meeting each other's need. You see them getting along. You see them disagreeing, but disagreeing maybe with love, if that's possible. They saw something different, and that radical difference was attractive to them. And it still is today. And it happens when we come with the nature of the church that is scriptural and is Christ intended. I think about my personal experience with this has always been that the moments when I say I'm not getting anything out of church, it wasn't the church's fault. Because the church, wherever I was a member or attending, had plenty of stuff going on. I just wasn't embracing it. I wasn't making the decision to incorporate into that community of faith. I think if I had, I probably wouldn't have been saying that. The nature of the church is very much the epitome of the cliche saying, you get out of it what you put into it. The way we engage our faith, The way we engage our community of faith has everything to do with how God is going to work through it. And scripturally, and I can tell you personally, there's no question. When we engage the community of faith the way God has called us to engage it, it is a magnificent experience. It is an experience that brings joy and purpose, peace, grace, and mercy into our lives and into the world. It's an experience that reassures us that we are right before God, because we are following the one who redeemed us. And so my encouragement for each of us as we move forward together is to embrace the nature of the church. To find those places where we are called to serve. To find those places where we are called to love and embrace one another, and in so doing, embrace the call of God on our lives. To find those opportunities to grow in faith, to understand more about who Christ is, who Christ calls us to be. To take notes from this chapter in Acts 6, and if we see a need, bring up the need. And don't just bring up the need, but be bold and courageous enough to also say, and I'm willing to be the one that will spearhead what it takes to see that this need is met. We are gifted, each of us, in miraculous and amazing ways that are unique to us. It's unique to you. And when we bring ourselves together before God, then the body of Christ becomes complete. And the more complete the body of Christ is, the greater our relationship together and our relationship to God. The more we project the love of Christ into the world out there, the more we invite the world out there into relationship with Christ. In other words, the more we become and are the church that Christ always intended the church to be. Would you bow your heads with me? Gracious God, we thank you that we have a safe and warm place to come together and worship. We thank you all the more for the people that gather here and worship with us. Lord, I ask that you would help us to embrace each other all the more fully. I pray that you would help us each to continue to find, understand, and use the gifts that you have placed within us. And Lord, to let the Holy Spirit be that glue that binds us together, that draws the body of Christ together as one, and that as our gifts merge with one another, uplift this congregation, and strengthen our ministry as we strive to spread the light of Christ into the world. Watch over each of us, comfort us, let us know that we are loved, and let the love that we feel from you inspire the love that we have for the world. In Jesus' name.